Okay, so I was here last year, gave a talk and you know, introduced Classroom Salon. It has gone through many, many changes since that time. And I was quite nervous when Daniel was talking about it a lot because I was just sitting here. And I'm one of the developers, and I'm responsible for any pain and suffering you had to go through using the tool. In fact, what we learned was a big lesson, like the usability needs to be improved. So we worked on that quite a bit, yeah. So let me just give you a few things about Classroom Salon here. All right, a few slides. So it's really a social annotation tool. I worked with the head of English, David Coffer, to develop this because I really didn't understand the humanities side. I showed him this tool that can sort of, what we wanted to do is to use computer science and humanities to kind of see whether we can understand people reading the text deeply. So where do they focus on, what kind of things they really care about, and so on. So we developed this tool. It's a social annotation, so we wanted to make sure that everyone's annotations are visible to everyone else, and you can do a lot of different things with it. Okay, so since last time, we have added videos into the collection, so now you can add in YouTube or Vimeo video, and you can get very specific location-based annotations. It will mark up whenever you make a comment about something, it'll know where exactly what part of the video that you're talking about. So, and then we, what we wanted to do is really, what we're working really hard now is to get this discussion going. Daniel talked about this, and I was listening very carefully about, you know, why the students are not talking to each other. Okay, there are a lot of reasons for that, but we want to try to enable this sort of, you know, private grouping kind of features to get them to talk to each other, talk to people that they trust, that sort of thing. So we are working on that this summer, trying to get a deep discussion going under any piece of text or any video frame. That's really the goal here. All right, so a quick summary of what the Salon does. You can upload your content, your document, images, videos, and then you have to prepare your documents. That's very important, because the students need to know that the instructor actually has put time into getting these things into the system, and the instructor actually want to know what they have. That's where, if the instructor is not involved, what we find out from the studies is that they're not doing it. They think that the instructor is not looking at them, and they don't really care, they don't like the tool. This is one of the other, you know, one of those things that you have to work on. So you have to really spend time adding tags and anchoring questions. And Daniel showed us some of the tags that he has added. So one of the ways that you can use tags is to add tags that you like, you know, discuss in class, this is important, I need a clarification here. So what you can do with Classroom Salon is to filter by those tags. And you can just isolate those comments based on those tags, and then use that as your class discussions, whatever you want to do it. Students can interact with your content individually, so you can set up times in Classroom Salon to say, I want the students to individually work on the document or video, or they can work as a group. So you can open it up anytime. So there's ways to control the access time. And then I think the big idea in Classroom Salon is the hotspot. You know, what part of the document or the video frame is really interesting, or find some discourse, needs clarification, some area of interest for further discussions. Because this is, I think, it's really important for the flipped classroom, because if you can discover these analytics before the class, you can actually have a good set of things that you want to do in the class. Because you have gotten them to do something before the class, so you know what they did, you have all the analytics available to you, and you can use that to drive the class. So you want to use the content hotspots to drive the class discussion, and then for students to discover self-organized group. Actually, I'll show you some of the new things that we have added to the Classroom Salon to see that how the groups are forming around content. That's really interesting. We like this idea of self-organizing group. Rather than putting the people into groups, we want to know where do they really find interesting things to find some common interest to talk about, right? Some discourse. And that's the ideal group, really. We can get that to work, right? Through technology, maybe we can find that. And I think the grading student participation is also very important. This we found out from the studies we did that you want to reward people who are actively commenting or replying to other people's comments or receiving replies to their comments. And then also we have a voting system on Salon now. Okay, so document creation, we are really the big idea of, we are really simplifying the document creation process. So these are some of the screenshots that will be integrated into Salon this summer. Now once you upload a document, you can set your tags, okay? And then you can put your discussion prompts. Now these are the prompts added by the instructor. So they are marked very distinctly, so you know what those discussion prompts are. I'm sorry, this image is not that clear. So you just add discussion prompts and then set your discussion schedule. So you know when to do the individual work, when to do the group work, and so on. So then once the students do the annotation, the Salon is going to change its look and feel a little bit here, like the hotspots will appear here instead of there. Okay, so that's it's going through changes. So that's, and then we have filters. You can look at the filter the all the comments, or you can look at the instructor comments, or you can look at your group comments kind of things. And then the latest and the most active and the most voted comments. So you can get them very, very quickly. Actually, Markus gave me a nice idea that you need to have a slider here that you can move, and then it'll filter by the date, the time. You can use any way you want it, right? So I think that's a good idea. Okay, so the hotspots are going to change like this. Sort of, you can actually go to a specific hotspot, read the comments and the tags they use and the people who are in those hotspots. Okay. All right, so let's do some demos here. I don't know which tool you want to see. The PDF tool, I can start with that.
Sure, yes.
Okay, let's do that. Most of you are waiting for the PDF tool.
So, has the PDF tool been incorporated yet?
Or? Yeah, it is. So, it is kind of like it's developing as a separate tool right now. Mm-hmm. It's called Flip. You can see the Flip shirt that I'm wearing. It's called Flip Your Training, but it's actually the commercial side of Classroom Salon. It's been used by for commercial training, corporate training kind of issues. So, you'll have a free version of the Flip tool for classrooms. So, the idea is that it's very simple. You can see that we learned a lot of lessons from, you want to create something really simple. So you have salons, documents, you have your accounts and so on. And if you go to a salon, let's go to this salon here. So the salons have documents. And so you can pick any document which is uploaded as a PDF. And so you can look at this. And it'll open up the document. And it'll show us the, here's a recipe that you're talking about, right? So if you have some questions and some comments about something, you can say, something like, can I jump two onions? And then you can add a tag. So the tags are like, I need a clarification for that. So I can use the tag that's been added by the instructor, and then I can make it private. That's the other thing we have, which is kind of, I'm not totally in favor of this because I think the annotation should be public. But what we will do is that if they make it private, we will hide their name, but we'll still show the text, right? we have to be a little bit careful as you're not talking about their names and things like that in the common text, which you cannot figure out. Right? So then you save it, and so it appears here. So notice that the clarification is here, and then if you click, it'll take you to that, and that takes you to that. You can respond to it. So it's a very simple way to really do things. And hopefully what Daniel said is true, actually. The students don't like to read online ever.
I just have a question. When you put this up, when the students see the document, is it possible for you to set it up so that when they first go through and make their annotations, they can't see other people's annotations?
Yes.
And so yeah. Is that what yeah. it is we're seeing here? Or?
Yeah, right now we are seeing it because it's set up to be seen by everyone. Mm-hmm. But if you actually set your schedule, so let's get real. We'll take you to one of the my salons here. So if you look at one of the documents, and if you go to the, you can set the access time. Mm-hmm. You can set the discussion schedule for the individual or for the group, so you mm-hmm. can control that.
But can you control, what I would like to be able to do is have each student independently enter their comments about seeing each other's first and then flip it so that
yeah.
you can do that?
That's what you can do with that the document manager, yeah.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
So you set the time saying, okay, it's individual until tomorrow.
Oh, I see.
And then you
I
open
got,
it up.
I got it. Great.
And then you can close it again if you want.
I see. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You can make it individual mm-hmm. again. Uh-huh. All right, so the, and the filters are now the sort of, you can filter by various things, so you can find out who commented and you can look at just one single person's comments and things like that. Okay. So that's a PDF tool. Now, if you like to use it, you know, I'll probably have a piece of paper here. You know, if you give me your email address or something, and then we can create an account and let you know. Yeah.
Is this for English only, or it supports foreign languages?
Oh no, you can use it for anything.
Okay. So can I put any document in any language?
Yeah, because any document. I mean, if it's a PDF, you should be able to upload any document. Now, Markus, you want to talk about your salon?
Sure.
Okay. Maybe I'll just show the rest of the features through Markus' salon.
Can I ask a quick question about the PDF, just to clarify. So the uploading PDFs is going to be integrated into Classroom Salon?
Yes.
Or it is already? Or?
It is already, and like I said, if you give me your name and or the email, you can upload a document here. Mm-hmm. You can just upload a document, choose your PDF.
But it's outside of, so like I already have a Classroom Salon account.
Yeah, you have to do, this is like a brand new
system.
Oh, okay,
system. So it's outside
of. So we're sort of re-architecting the whole thing.
I see.
We're slowly getting all the features
into
this.
If we had 10 or 12 PDFs, that would be doing you a tremendous amount of disservice and work.
No, 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 don't send me the PDF. You
yeah.
give me the PDF.
Yeah, yeah, it's just
create. I just create the account.
The account.
Right. Yeah, don't send me the PDF.
When would it be integrated?
What?
When would it be integrated?
Into the other
into class, yeah.
I think that we are thinking end of the summer we'll have some integration of the two platforms.
Okay.
Because some people like text, some people like PDF, some people like videos. So we got to get all three into one platform.
Just a quick question back to the foreign language. For PDF, I understand the new language would work, but as far as the comments go, different alphabets, things like that, does it work?
For the text, no. We don't support the other languages like Spanish or something. You have English characters you're trying, but not the other languages. Yeah. So Markus will show
us. Yeah,
okay, yeah, you can log in as yourself. Oh, yeah, I thought you could do that. And then I can show you Markus' class and how he, what kind of stuff.
So just a little bit of background. I may be one of Guna's most peskiest users. I use it for a graduate research, social science research method seminar, where we're trying essentially, it's very similar to what Daniel presented before. It's essentially trying sophomores and graduate students how to analyze text using social science methodology. Let me just show you, so one of the challenges is, you know, early on in the semester, we want them to know what is the structure of an argument, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, what is a thesis? What are reasons that support a thesis? Evidence, objections, and things like this. So what I, why is this about anxiety disorder? And so what I use is I use the text and the video features combined. So I created a little short video explaining, you know, this is a thesis, this is what it looks like. And so let me just, the structure of the argument, hopefully this is the, that's the video. So this is the video. So what you see is that they watch the video, and then if they have questions, right, they just enter the comments here below, and then the questions show up here, and then when we come to class, I can go over some of the questions they have and discuss them. So that's how I use the video. Another way I use the video is sometimes throughout the video, there's a slide in a different color where there is a question, right? Mm-hmm. So it's like in the Coursera things where you have the embedded sort of quiz. I use this, and then they have to type in the answer. So this is just in part for me to monitor whether they're learning what they're supposed to learn, or to make sure that they're actually doing it, right? Sort of a diagnostic tool. And then again, with the different view modes, I have it as individual view modes so that the student can copy the answers from somebody else. And then we open it up. I come to class, and then, yes.
And these little videos, what did you produce those in? What program did you use?
This is just a PowerPoint, and then with any screencast, you can capture that, or with Camtasia, depending on how fancy you want to get, right?
Yeah.
So this is sort of the content, the lecturing thing. And then comes the little exercise that follows. So what I did is I used a short article from James Suravicki from The New Yorker.
That's a big usability problem. You want to go to the home page and then sort your. You can sort most.
Let me just go to
your documents.
My documents.
How can you read this stuff?
Search.
There's a search. You can search by the title if you want to.
What's the name of what you're looking for?
It has the name Suravicki in it.
Okay, so search for Wiki thing. You can search the documents on the top.
Evidence. Oh, no, here, there it is. So what you see now, what comes up is the text is a very short text, right? I set the tags to the various elements of an argument, a thesis, right? Mm-hmm. An argument, and then they have to highlight it. So this is now the public view. Mm-hmm. This is pretty useless because you have all the annotations. So what I do is I come to class and then we filter. This is just to highlight the filter functionality. So you can filter now by tags, right? So I hide all the tags and I want to see where did they find the thesis? Now you see here, right? Most people here think this was the thesis. Mm-hmm. And you say, okay, and then if I scroll a little bit further down, there's nobody found the thesis at the end of the document. So that was good news, right? and then what you can do is you want to see, well, you highlight this area. Oops, sorry. I should close this. If I highlight now this area, it should bring up the refresher.
then it brings up the students who highlighted this area. So in class, like, oh, okay. So just work with me hypothetically here. You highlight this, right? And then you have the two students who thought this is a thesis. And in class said, Jennifer, why do you think this was the thesis as opposed to this? And then you can use this sort of to have it as a discussion. Exactly. Mm-hmm. This would be. And then you do the same thing with the other ends of the L. So that's sort of one way of doing it. Or another way use it is the course also sort of draws us around cognitive psychology, because you know one of the biggest impediments to analysis is all these cognitive biases that we have, and to sort of how to illustrate them. So in one example, I showed them a video from the Hannity, Sean Hannity, that you know during the election campaign, where he had big breaking news that Obama's video was discovered, right? And he gave a speech at Hampton College, and he had a different accent, right? So he was pandering to African American voters. So you first just show them the video and say, well, you know, what do you think? I mean, the clip in there is pretty sort of striking. He talks differently. And you let them record their responses, their initial responses, right? Then you block any further comments. Then you have them watch the actual speech, right? And then you say, well, what did they cherry pick from this, right? And you see the context of him. And then you sort of have the aha moment. You say, well, look, I mean, if you only cherry pick these pieces of evidence, or if you see the different context, all of a sudden, right, I talk differently when I talk to my kids than when I talk, you know, in front of a public audience. And then they have that aha moment, then you get them back to the video, they respond to it, and then you have a sort of discussion going. So this is how you use the sort of videos.
So I'll show some other things that maybe Marcus hasn't seen this, you know, in his own salon, because we have been developing these things. So one thing you see is that you can obviously sort by the most comments, so you know which document got the most comments, video or documents. So these are all documents here. That's 230 annotations in that document. So lots of annotations, and you can see the latest set of annotations by clicking there, but with the slider, all that can be simplified. But one other thing that's really important is that Marcus can look at the analytics. So if he clicks here, it's supposed to draw the graph of how people are doing in his class. So that's the date. So there's 112 annotations came on the 24th of March. And then you can see how big their circle is. The bigger the circle, they have done the most annotations, right? The next biggest question is that, how did they contribute? So you can look at the next tag, which shows you the people's contributions. How many questions they asked, how many comments they made, how many replies they received. So that could indicate a leading thinker kind of thing, or someone who's very controversial, right? So lots of things. And then the biggest question is, were there any discussions, right? Mm-hmm. And you go to the threads. Actually, Marcus had threads, but you can look at the thread, meaning that these are the analytics from the document. And you can actually look at this as a graph. It's kind of not interesting. Or as a list here. So here it is. So what this does is to extract the hotspot, the place that annotated by the most people, and then show you who annotated it and then how many replies you got. And in fact, I can show you an interesting graph. Yeah, so let's stick. And you can go through all the other hotspots. So these are all the threads. So what we like to do is to really build these threads. So this shows the tree of discussion. Mm-hmm. So this is where the discussion started. That's the context. First person made a comment, and then maybe several people reply to it, and so on. And then you can see the graph. In fact, as you move through the nodes, you can see it. Or you can click here, and it'll actually take you to the exact comment. It takes a while because if you have like a lot of comments, so this document has a lot of comments, but it takes you to the exact comment of that tree. So you can respond to that and extend that thread. That's what we're trying to do in the UI. So Marcus can look at the salon here. Oh, this is the recent, the most recent, right? Here, another thing. Let's go to this one. Yeah, this is spring 2015. One other thing he can do is to look at the grades and how people are really working in the salon. So this shows the trend of annotations. And he had 492 annotations in the salon, and the biggest contributor was Marcus. So that was
I just like salon.
Yeah. And here's another one. You can actually see the students' contributions. You can sort by the comments, comment length, how many people ask questions, how many replies you got, or how many replies you provided. And the consistency means that how often they get involved in this activity. So rather than doing 8 annotations on a single day, now you can look at the consistency and see, okay, they're working 8 annotations a day for 10 days, which is much better, right?
What does that number mean?
The consistency? Okay, so this is really the number of days the entire document was active. Actually, the number of days the person was active divided by the number of days the entire document was active. So it gives you the consistency.
It's a good predictor. The three students had the same consistency as I all ended up with an engine.
That's a good predictor, right? Let me see what other things I want to show you. Yeah, in terms of adding a video, it's fairly trivial. You just go to YouTube and find a video and add it. You can take any video here.
Why don't you show how to embed the comments in a video?
In a video, yeah, let's do that. Yeah. So let me put this video here. I have too many things open here. That was that. So once you put the video title here and then click here, it brings all the metadata from the YouTube, so you have the video available now. And then you save it. You can put that in a salon, or you can leave it like that. You can put that in, and I can put that in there. Let's see here. And there's the video. Now, if you want to put the video, so there's the video playing. So if you want to insert a question, you can insert a question here. Actually, I'm not the owner here, so I can't do that. Let me just get into that. So you can go to any place in the video and insert a question. Yes. That shows up, and then when the students are looking at things, you can click here. It'll jump to the exact location of the annotation where the annotation was made. So it's a good way, and then they can reply to it and create a discussion thread and all those things. We find this to be interesting. A lot of people are using it for their class because it's easy to get involved. One other thing I want to mention, because I think we are ready for lunch, is that one thing you could do is that the salon, most people use salon by including that in a course management system. So you put the salon links in your course structure, because salon doesn't create a structure for you. It's just like a repository of things and documents and videos. So if you take that URL and insert that in any course management system, students click on it and they go to that.
That's
a good one, yeah. And one other thing we are trying to do by the end of the summer is that we're going to integrate Salon with Blackboard, so that when you have a Blackboard course, you have a Salon and you have all the people are enrolled in. Mm-hmm. So it's easy, you just put the documents and get the...
Why not Moodle?
I should do that. We're working with Princeton. Princeton wanted the Blackboard integration.
Last year when I was here with you, I got very excited about Salon because I wanted desperately to put my textbook on Salon.
Yeah.
And because one of the examples you showed us was very exciting, had textbook chapters on Salon. So my intro psych students would benefit tremendously for all the hotspots, let me tag this, ask this question, and so on. Both publishers turned me down.
Oh, okay.
They said no, even with your name attached.
Oh.
And I said, because they're gonna, Salon is going to eat your lunch. The publishers really should be doing this. I promised them that I would have the students buy the book before I made this available. No. So I'm thinking about going rogue and putting stuff up anyway if I can.
Well, this is a textbook. That's a free textbook.
Yeah.
It's a PDF that has 384 pages. Mm-hmm. That's imported into Salon. Okay, so find free textbooks, because I think we have to go against the publishers. Too much of a monopoly there, right? There's a lot of good content available. Take them, put it in there, and get the students to talk about it.
Is there the ability for students to upload their own documents for peer review? Okay,
yeah, you can. We have nice, there's a course from Yale that has a nice, I think that's, they do that a lot. I have too many, so thank you. But
So it's there.
Yale has a course where the students upload their writings, and then they assign other people to comment. They say, you know, you have to do at least three of these papers. And then you can collect all the analytics and see exactly at the
You said you could put a link in your course management system, but then obviously the students have to create an account and with their name, because when you look at all this, every comment is tagged with a name.
That's right. So the students have to create a Salon account only once, and then you have to create the Salon, and you have to enroll them in the Salon.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's what we're trying to avoid with the Blackboard integration, maybe modal integration at some point.
That's next.
Right? So that you don't have to do that, right? So you have one single authentication and everything works in this responsible way. Yeah, I think as far as publishers are concerned, I'm as frustrated as you are. I think we're trying to get books into Salon so that people can use it.
Mm-hmm.
But
I would be happy just with the text file.
Yeah.
Forget the images, just the text file. They can have the hard copy book.
But now when they're doing their own textbook course management stuff.
They don't
do the social.
No, they mark up
their own books. They don't do the social aspect.
Some of them just have questions, and when you get it wrong, it sends you to a paragraph in the textbook.
Yeah.
So students never have the reading, struggle through the reading kind of thing.
But there are a couple of course, I mean, Educause did a pilot in the last couple of semesters. One publisher, or one platform is called Course Load, Colgate. We piloted that this semester. It was pretty bad. The other one that looked a lot better, I saw it at the NERCOM conference, was called Course Smart.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, there are, and they all have social components. They talk about, you know, pretty much what you have going here, except they are tied into a fee, because you have to buy the textbook.
And they're also tied to a particular book, so not
you
might run into the situation where half of your faculty are using one platform
Absolutely.
And half the other, and because you're having to pay for it, you can't get. Whereas this is.
I think the best thing is just keep it free and then let people upload their own content. You have to worry about your copyright things, because Salon is not going to worry about that. And. You know, it's just like a YouTube kind of thing. If someone complains, we will remove the document, but otherwise it'll be there.
So how are you making money?
That's why we have a commercial. Sorry, that's for the corporate training.
Yeah.
That's how we are making money. So that's been very successful. That's for sure, of course, is we're using Salon as a place to have a conversation.
Okay. Lunch.
Yeah.